Chris Walker, Executive Director of the International Forum for Democratic Studies at the National Endowment for Democracy. And on behalf of NED's International Forum, I'm pleased to welcome everyone to today's presentation, Ukraine's Lessons Learned from the Orange Revolution to the Euromaidan, featuring Reagan-Fascell Democracy Fellow Sergii Leshchenko. Save the applause for after the event. We're delighted to have two discussants with us today that are deeply knowledgeable about Ukraine. Nadia Duke is Vice President of Programs for Africa, Latin America, and Eurasia at the NED. And Matthew Kaminsky is a member of the editorial board of the Wall Street Journal. Both of them have spent considerable time in Ukraine. They've written extensively on the country, and they're really terrific experts on it. Funded by the U.S. Congress, the Reagan-Fascell Democracy Fellows Program hosts some of the world's most dedicated democracy activists, scholars, and journalists to conduct independent research and pursue projects here at NED. Now in our 13th year, the program has hosted more than 200 fellows from over 80 countries since its founding in 2001. Following its failure to consolidate democratic gains of the much-celebrated 2004 Orange Revolution, Ukraine, under the increasingly corrupt and coercive rule of President Viktor Yanukovych, has suffered numerous setbacks in its struggle to achieve a more democratic system. Recent mass protests in Kyiv, which have come to be known as the Euromaidan, erupted in response to the president's rejection in November of the European Union Association Agreement that would have brought Ukraine in the direction of Europe. Since the onset of the protests, the government has resorted to increasingly brutal force against peaceful protesters as part of a deepening crackdown in the country. In his presentation, Sergii Leshchenko will discuss the Euromaidan in the context of the democratization process that began in 2004 and will address the implications of the current protests on Ukraine's political future. Sergii is a Kyiv-based journalist, blogger, and press freedom activist who helped launch the Stop Censorship movement in 2010 in defense of free speech in Ukraine. Since 2000, he's worked for Ukrainska Pravda, Ukraine's leading online newspaper, where he specializes in anti-corruption investigations and other political reporting. In the year leading up to Ukraine's 2012 legislative elections, he participated in the Chesno campaign that called for transparency and accountability in parliament. In 2011, Poland's Foundation of Reporters recognized Sergii as the best journalist within the country of the Eastern Partnership, and in 2012, he was awarded a John Smith Fellowship based in London and Edinburgh, where he participated in a three-week program on good governance, social justice, and rule of law. In 2013, Sergii was awarded a press prize by the Norwegian Fritz Ord Foundation and the German Zeit Foundation. He's the author of The American Saga of Pavlo Lazarenko, a book about the investigations of former Ukrainian Prime Minister Pavlo Lazarenko, conducted by U.S. law enforcement agencies. During his fellowship, Sergii is working on an article examining what went wrong after Ukraine's Orange Revolution. Our first discussant, Nadia Duke, is NED's Vice President for Programs here. Prior to her appointment to this position, she supervised NED programs in Europe and Eurasia, where she worked on strategies for the democratic movements before 1989 through the dissolution of the Soviet Union, Yugoslavia, and beyond. Our second discussant, Matthew Kaminsky, is a member of the Wall Street Journal's editorial board, a position he assumed in 2008. For the previous 3 years, Mr. Kaminsky was the editorial page editor at the Wall Street Journal Europe, based in Paris. He joined the journal in 1997 as a reporter in Brussels and specialized in security issues, Central Europe, and the Balkans. And before joining the journal, Matt was a Financial Times and Economist reporter on the Soviet Union from 1993 to 1997. So now we'll turn the floor over to Sergii, who will speak for approximately 30 minutes, to be followed by Nadia and Matt. For those of you on Twitter, you can follow this presentation and contribute to the conversation by using the hashtag NEDEvents or by following the International Forum at Think Democracy. And you can follow the endowment at NEDDemocracy. And if you haven't already done so, we please ask that you take a moment to silence your cell phones and finally, let me take this opportunity to thank staff members Sally Blair, Xerxes Spencer, Melissa Aiton McNell, Ashley Walden, Sarah Amin, Hillary Collins, Dean Jackson, and most especially, Research Associate Marlena Papadaritis for their help organizing today's event.
And thank you for this opportunity to participate in this fellowship in Washington. And thank you for the opportunity to leave Washington for participating in the Maidan in December this year. In the end of November, I called my friend, well-known Ukrainian journalist Mustafa Nayev. I asked him, Mustafa, what is going on in Ukraine? Should I come back? And he said, no, everything is fine. You shouldn't go back. And I asked him, but what is going on? He said, just 500,000 people went to Maidan, so you can stay in the US. So. And yes, I came back to Ukraine to cover a little bit this event, and then I came back to Washington to complete my fellowship, and today I have the final presentation. This is the structure of our presentation. We'll discuss about the Ukraine after the revolution, about Euromaidan and about conclusions and recommendations. So, just to remind, what is Ukraine in the global perspective? It's few quotes from different but very well-known people about Ukraine. One of them is Larry Diamond, the professor from Stanford, who said that Ukraine is a swing state between East and West. Zbigniew Brzezinski said that no Russian empire without Ukraine. It's the well-known phrase of this person, and I met him during my fellowship. Thank you for this opportunity provided by that. Also, Samuel Huntington said that the dividing line in Europe separates Catholic Western from Orthodox Eastern Ukraine. And the last person that I met the quote is President of Russia, Vladimir Putin, who said that the collapse of the Soviet Union was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. These phrases could understand us better what is going on now in Ukraine and in Europe. Do you remember the Orange Revolution? Of course you remember it was happened in the year 2004, almost 10 years ago, and Orange Revolution was only 7 days long from the second round of the presidential elections to the decision of Supreme Court to have the third round, so-called third round of presidential election. And now you can see that current revolution in Ukraine, it was started in November, and this week is, as I remember, it's so there are 10 weeks from the beginning now. And I don't understand, and I don't know, and nobody knows when will be the solution of this current crisis. So that revolution was much, much faster, and the result was without any victims, and no barricades was built, no were built in Kiev, and no use of brute force from the government as well. Let's go to mistakes after the Orange Revolution. First of all, you know, everybody knows that there were lack of power sharing consensus because of the constitution by President Yushchenko and Prime Minister Tymoshenko. We're in a permanent conflict because of Greek constitution, and it created the situation when President and Prime Minister by staying in permanent fighting for the rating, for the people's votes, and the result was the collapse of so-called Orange Dream. Also, there was lack of understanding the governmental process in new team. One moment, I would like to add that President Leshchenko often absent from Ukraine to collect awards. During my fellowship, I met Morgan Williams from U.S.-Ukraine Business Council, and he recalled that he met Leshchenko in Philadelphia a few days before the voting for new prime minister after the resignation of Prime Minister Yulia Tymoshenko. And he was in Philadelphia because of that award. He really didn't care about the political process at the time, just months after the Orange Revolution. And also another significant point from that period that President Leshchenko undergo through 26 surgeries because of poison. So he was really weak during that period of time. Here I would like to quote former ambassador in Kiev, Steve Python, who recalled that once he came to presidential administration in Kiev, and he noticed that Yushchenko's administration criticized Prime Minister Tymoshenko, and he asked why. Why do you criticize Tymoshenko? Steve Python asked his friend in presidential administration, and he said, and the counterpart of Steve Python answered, because we want to destroy Tymoshenko's rating as competitor in presidential elections. Also, there was absence of reform agenda in Ukraine after the Orange Revolution. No anti-corruption or energy reforms. And of course, you remember that Yushchenko left on the position of prosecutor general, the person who was prosecutor during Kuchma's time, the president who was resigned after the Orange Revolution. Also, Yushchenko accepted corrupted energy schemes of Rosatomenergo, this company created under cover of Russian criminal authority, Simon Mogilevich. There also were no real infrastructure of democracy, weak civil society and watchdog institutions, weak rule of law, unreformed state television and non-transparent public services. And Yulia Tymoshenko, one of the factors of current developments in Ukraine. Here you can see the political advertisement from election campaign 2006. Role of Yulia Tymoshenko. I would like to quote Andrei Leonov, the famous Russian analyst and former advisor of President Putin, who now based in Washington as a fellow Cato Institute, and he said during our meeting a few months ago, he said that Yulia Tymoshenko didn't have any political platform. And I think that it was also one of the factors of political development in Ukraine, that she didn't stay on the position of political or democratic reform. She was only interested in her support and rating. And she provided a lot of populist steps. Tymoshenko also was involved in corruption schemes with ex-Prime Minister Pavel Lazarenko. I found out during my investigation in California that she paid 50% of her profits to him. But at the same time, Tymoshenko was sentenced by political reasons in the year 2011. And U.S. Senate resolutions also stated this, and we didn't find any proofs of her personal, political, or money interest in this gas deal with Russia, which was the reason of her sentencing. Also, association agreement with the European Union became a hostage of Tymoshenko's fate, because, as you know, the European Union didn't sign the agreement while Tymoshenko was in prison. Let's go to the another part of our presentation, the rise of Yanukovych and his family. There is a photo from the inauguration of President Yanukovych in February 2010, after the presidential election. Yanukovych represents a powerful and brutal clan, the clan number one in Ukraine. And the former leader of this clan was killed by the explosion at the football stadium in year 2010. Forbes estimates his worth is $500 million. During the scholarship, I met Professor Dr. Bob Orton from Washington University, and it was in November, even in October, few weeks before the Vilnius summit, and we could not imagine what would be going on in Ukraine. And he said that Professor Orton said that Yanukovych will never leave power willingly because he is corrupt and afraid of possible prosecution. And now we have a lot of proofs of this statement. So, secession agreement was, in my understanding, it was dangerous for Yanukovych because association agreement may prevent Yanukovych's plan to falsify presidential election 2015, and this was the main reason why he didn't sign this agreement. Euromaidan. Ukrainian government postpones Eurointegration 1 week before Vilnius summit. Of course, you remember these events, these dramatic events in November 2012 and 2013. When young people started together on the main square in Kiev after the block, or even not a block, a post on the Facebook page by prominent Ukrainian journalist Mustafa Nayev. And here you can see his photo on the cover page of Polish newspaper Gazeta Wyborcza. So Euromaidan started after this post and his invitation to stay together on Maidan, and just only a few hundred people came to Maidan on the first day. What were the preconditions for Euromaidan? In my understanding, the first precondition was that a new generation of young Ukrainians was growing up after the Orange Revolution. These people were 10 or 15 years old in 2004, when was Orange Revolution, and now in current situation, they try to implement their knowledge and their memory about that event. And also people remember the successful mobilization of the Orange Revolution. If you remember, how did the Orange Revolution start? What do you need for the beginning of revolution? First you need tents, then you need stage, third you need barrels for fire, and fourth you need barricades to start the revolution. It's like precondition in our Ukraine. But by the way, there were no barricades in the year 2004. Now we have dozens of barricades in the central part of Kiev, and I can even say that we have enclave in the downtown of Ukrainian capital. The police cannot even enter this part of the city. Also, NGOs play a more prominent role in Ukraine now, and I would like to recall an organization called Chesno, which is now under criminal prosecution in Ukraine because of money laundering. By the way, this organization is financed by international and American organizations like PACT and Swedish SIDA, so I don't really understand what Ukrainian authorities mean, that this organization laundered American money, or what is the purpose of this prosecution. I believe that only purpose for this prosecution is to demobilize people and to fear them. Also, another precondition of current situation in Ukraine, that oligarchs begin to leave from the Yanukovych circle. As usually, they started to hedge their bets. And from year 2004, business remembered the positive experience of support of opposition. There was the war of arrogance before the and before, just after the beginning of Euromaidan. And I really like this statement of former Ukrainian Prime Minister Mykola Azanov, who said that legalization of gay marriage is the precondition of European integration. It was just a fake argument, and the main point for me that Prime Minister Azanov led Ukraine to Europe just after the resignation in January this year. This argument doesn't play a role for him. with Russia would reduce GDP by 4%. So let's go to next slide. This well-known photo after the deal between Yanukovych and Putin. Russia agreed to pay $15 billion as loan to Ukrainian government instead of decision of Yanukovych to left the negotiation with European Union. Also, as we know from the latest development, Russia started to play political role in Ukrainian politics. Presidential advisor of President Putin, Vladislav Surkov, became the person who is in charge of Ukrainian issues now in Kremlin. What about Euromaidan? Here some information about leaders and phases of Euromaidan. First phase was non-political Maidan prior to November crackdown, and the leaders of that Maidan was journalist Mustafa Nayem and singer Ruslana, the winner of Eurovision song competition from 2004. Second phase is political Maidan from December. After the brutal crackdown, the leaders of that part of Maidan became Klitschko, Yatsenyuk, and Petrov, leaders of three political parties represented in parliament. And then civil society Maidan. I believe that it was also started from December 2013 until now, and in this part of Maidan, so-called civil society Maidan, there are also few leaders like Bulatov, who is one of the organizers of Auto Maidan, also journalist Tatiana Chernarov, who was beaten, Andriy Poruby, so-called commander of Maidan, and a lot of other people like IT specialists, singers, medics, and so on. And radical part of Maidan from January 2014 to present time. It's radical right parties, football ultras, veterans of war in Afghanistan. And also, I would like to provide this information that Yulia Tymoshenko cannot include in protest agenda. Only 30% of respondents mentioned her release as demand of Euromaidan. It's the latest numbers from Ukrainian research of the structure of Euromaidan. I think it was a point of no return in the current situation in Ukraine when Ukrainian parliament adopted dictatorship law, and after that protesters attacked riot police with stones and Molotov cocktails. And these photos were on the front pages all over the world in January last month. What is the demands of Euromaidan now? First of all, it's signing of association agreement. It is demand of Maidan so far. Another demand is resignation of Minister of Internal Affairs and other officials responsible for use of forms. A resignation of President now has 85% of support among protesters. And this number increased by 20% since December. It was happened just after the crackdown and the voting for dictatorship law it is the result, in fact, of this voting from January 16, when parliament adopted this dictatorship package. So, separation of power and new constitution also is among demands of Maidan. Release of protesters who are arrested and end of repressions, also demand of Maidan. And a very sensitive issue is guarantees for President Yanukovych, because a lot of European and American analysts and political scientists believe that Ukrainian opposition has to provide some guarantees to Yanukovych, because it's only a precondition for him to leave the power. But this idea is extremely unpopular among Ukrainian protesters. Only 17% ready to provide such guarantees to Yanukovych. Structure of Maidan. In fact, it's not like a Maidan, it's a separate country within another country. So what do we have on Ukrainian Maidan now? We have accommodation, food courts, And there's some information from Kyiv that in December there was prepared 110,000 portions of food during single one day in December. So over than 100,000 portions. I cannot imagine what kind of McDonald's could prepare so many food, you know. Also, headquarters of trade union on Maidan in Kyiv became the home for 2,000 protesters. So at least 2,000 people can sleep on the floor in this trade union building, and I was the witness. In December last year, when Senator McCain was going through this corridor and people were laid on the floor, and he was just going through this crowd of people on the floor to the special room for interview with my newspaper. It was, I think, one of the most interesting experiences from the last decades, maybe. Also, we have medical assistance on Maidan, we have churches on Maidan, we have University of Maidan, we have press center, and we have newspaper of Maidan, we have military forces of Maidan, we have Facebook page of Maidan, and there 220,000 followers. This number is twice larger than the number of followers on my newspaper. Can you imagine that we collected these followers during maybe 6 or 7 years, and Euromaidan Facebook page collected these followers during few weeks, you know? Also, we have volunteers and translators on Maidan, and you know, people all over the Ukraine or all over the world even can help us to translate articles about Ukraine and put it on the pages of Facebook, on different other medias, and even some people from Washington, I don't know, is this person in this room or not, but I know that some Ukrainian activists helped me to translate some articles from Ukrainian to English and to publish it on our website, so thank you for this person, of course. And donation. You know that people just put their money in special transparent boxes on my account, and we have some information that during one day it was the biggest amount, $50,000 were collected during one day on Maidan. And this is non-stop process. I cannot say that every day we could collect $50,000, but it was the record, the biggest amount during one day in December. Art of barricades. This is one of the newest photos from Maidan, when painter just, you know, painting the from barricades on Grushevskaya Street. On this photo, you can see my colleagues from international media. There are cameramen from international news agencies. This guy is from German newspaper, Frankfurter Allgemeine, and another cameraman. So it's unbelievable that, you know, in 21st century, in downtown of European capital, you can see like this decoration and this journalist who work in these conditions. Let's discuss about who are the Maidan 2014. So there are 88% of men, and I'm sorry, but only 12% of women. So the revolution is like, you know, there is nothing to do with gender balance. Average age, 37 years. 12% of participants are Kyiv residents, 55% from Western Ukraine and 45% from Central and Eastern Ukraine, apart from this 12% from Kyiv. And among all Maidaners, 59% speak Ukrainian as primary language. For somebody, it could be proved that, you know, on Maidan there are only guests of Kyiv and no support from the capital. It's not true, because people from Kyiv, they provide to Maidan like food, accommodations. My friends of mine who has possibility in Kyiv, they invited guests of Maidan to stay in their apartment during the night, to take a shower, to wash the stuff they need, to do everything. colleagues of Maidan. It's a tragedy. So we have 4 confirmed deaths. We have cases of torture among of these Russian colleagues. A lot of Belarus people, these names are well known all over the world now. 300 activists were arrested in the past few weeks. Ages range from 15 to 73 years old. Can you imagine that? 73 years old activist was arrested in Ukraine during last week. As I know, he was released a few weeks ago, but he was staying in detention center for a few days. Over 1,700 people injured since beginning of protest in November 2013. On this photo you see the victims of Maidan, 2 Ukrainians, 1 Belarus, people, 1 person from Belarus and 1 Armenian. Yuri Verbitsky, Mikhail Zhizdevsky, Sergei Hayat and Roman Sen. These 4 persons are confirmed as victims of Maidan. 2 of them were, 3 of them were shot and 1 person died because of torches. On this photo you can see one of the activists who was beaten by police. He is on the stage in press center of opposition in trade union building. Activists Bulatov kidnapped, tortured and then released. And on this dramatic, even maybe ugly, but it's real photo, you can see that his ear was cut. Police shoot at protesters in Kiev during the violence in January. Targeting of journalists. Over 80 journalists injured during the confrontation in January and February. And these people were beaten mostly by police. On this photo you can see journalist Tatiana Chernova brutally beaten in December. And you know, today we have a news from Ukraine that person who are under suspicion in this case were released from their arrest in Ukraine. On this photo you can see a journalist from Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty. It's American TV and radio station founded by Congress. And these reporters also were kidnapped and beaten by police. Myth of the Euromaidan, anti-Semitism. In fact, there is no evidence of anti-Semitism in Ukraine, and if you don't believe me, just go to the post of well-known Ukrainian painter Alexander Roybut. He is Jewish and he said there is no evidence, he participates in Maidan every day, and it's like a myth created by Russia propaganda machine. Second myth, American money. There is no American money, unfortunately or fortunately, on Maidan. Third myth is Russian special forces. There are a lot of rumors, but we don't have any proofs of it. We can only speculate about this. And fourth, opposition controls protesters. It's not a truth. I could say that protesters control opposition, in fact. Not opposition controls them. Geopolitical actors, export of dictatorship laws, weapons, and FSB consultants from Russia. On this photo you can see some weapons from these weapons. These weapons were produced in Russia and the Ukrainian government approved the act which provides the opportunity to import these weapons from Russia to Ukraine. Also the Ukrainian government and the Ukrainian Party of Russia adopted Russia laws and there's a lot of information confirmed that people connected with FSB are working now as advisors in Ukrainian police forces and in presidential administration. Geopolitical actors, what was the reaction of the United States? US imposes first round of sanctions and European Union still debated about this issue. And yesterday there was the decision of European Council that there are no sanctions for Ukrainian government so far, but in case of crackdown, they will adopt sanctions as well. How useful are, what is the role of sanctions? In this case, I would like to quote former Ambassador John Herbst. Also, I interviewed him during my fellowship. He said that the best place for oligarchs to enjoy the stolen wealth sanctions is a very serious instrument to pressure on the Ukrainian government. And I completely agree with this point of view. This cartoon from New York Times, you can see that there is a Ukrainian police-wise protesters and European officials. And I believe that this mood is very spread among Ukrainian protesters, that European Union doesn't care about Ukrainians in this situation. Results of Euromaidan so far. So Lenin's statue destroyed in the first result. Prime Minister Azarov resigned, so at least we have two, like, two achievements and two victims of Euromaidan, Azarov and Lenin. Yanukovych re-election less likely now, I believe so. Party of Region more divided now, and there are a lot of rumors that among Party of Region some people don't really want to support Yanukovych and they want to leave this party, but Yanukovych really pushed them to stay in party. No new programming projects on horizon in Ukraine now. These projects are based in Kharkiv, the second capital of Ukraine. Russian influence increased during last months. Protesters radicalized, lost confidence in opposition. And we have a lot of criminal cases against NGO, civil society activists, just activists, and repression are increasing now in Ukraine. Another result is just militarization of protest. You know that it became popular among young Ukrainians to be part of so-called self-defense, self-defense of Maidan, you know, and this is not American troops. This is Ukrainians on Maidan, and they look like, you know, the real fighters. Scenarios for Ukraine, the last part of our presentation. I believe that there are four scenarios. Positive scenario, new constitution, national unity government, and snap presidential elections. It's positive scenario, but it's difficult to predict will it happen or not. Possible scenario, degradation of Maidan and presidential elections in 2015. United candidate from opposition is crucial in this case. I believe that this scenario is much more possible than the first one. Negative scenario, further escalation of crisis, possibly break down this unpredictable outcome. Also, this scenario is very possible now in Ukraine, and extremely negative scenario, brutal crackdown, intervention of Russia, and dissolution of Ukraine. We cannot exclude anything in this situation now. Is Ukrainian new constitution a part of the solution? I believe that it could be one of the solutions, and the switch to parliamentary system over presidential has some pros and some cons. Among pros, more stakeholders, more debates in Ukrainian politics, access of young generation to political process. And cons, oligarchs could increase influence through members of parliament. Every oligarch will have like 5, 6, 7 people. They will influence on Ukrainian politics. Oligarchs will influence on Ukrainian politics using this new constitution, which provides more rights to parliament and to government. And of course, parliamentary republic provides more opportunities for Russia to influence on political process in Ukraine. Future of Ukrainian democracy. Among others, militarization of Ukrainian politics. It was happened after the crackdown, and people now, they want to feel themselves brave, I mean protesters, they want to feel themselves brave, and they started this militarization of protest. And you cannot just switch off this process, you know. Risk of witch hunt campaign against civil society and NGOs receiving foreign funding. This risk also in Ukraine now. Further division of Ukrainian society. New actors among Yanukovych supporters with direct Kremlin support. New project which was started a few weeks ago in Kharkiv with direct support from Moscow, and they created so-called Ukrainian front, and they invited local people to participate in this movement against Maidan. seen the Ruslan commander, Albi, and the other people, I believe that they will play much more, their role will be much more in a few years. Geopolitical results. Euromaidan could be a positive example for Russian opposition, and you know that among Russia opposition leaders, a lot of people visited Kyiv during the last weeks, and yesterday Ksenia Sobchak also was in Kyiv, and they just, you know, visited not only because of fun, but because of, you know, case study for Russian opposition as well. West may consider Ukraine's future potential EU member state. I believe that it could be one of the geopolitical results of Euromaidan. And Euromaidan is a good opportunity for the United States policymakers to understand global security importance of Ukraine. And one recommendations, I would like to mention the sanctions against Ukrainian oligarchs and politics who do not respect human rights values and who support crackdown. And on this photo you can see one of the property of the richest Ukrainian oligarch, Ivan Akhmetov. This property is located in West Virginia, not far from here. He is owner of United Coal Company, and he paid $1 billion for this company a few years ago. And I believe that Ukrainian oligarchs should feel that they will have the sanctions in case they support crackdown and bloody regime in Ukraine. Recommendations. New Marshall Plan for Ukraine in case of EU government. There are a lot of negotiation about that, that United States, IMF and European Union could collect some money, about $15 billion, to support Ukraine instead of Russia, but only in case of new government and unpopular reforms. Also, support for infrastructure of democracy in Ukraine. It means rule of law, independence of judges, public television, and so far. Another recommendations I could ask, and I think it's useful, that United States and Europe have to press Russia to recognize Ukrainian European aspiration. So that's it. Yeah. Thank you very much. And if you're interested, please follow me. Maybe leave this for a while. Excuse me, maybe leave the contact information.
Sergii, first of all, let me thank you for a terrific presentation. It was really a great survey of what's emerged, and I think your observations are extremely helpful as a lead-in for the discussion now. And with that, I'm very happy to start with Nadia.
Thank you. Thank you, Sergii. I mean, I think that was actually a very extremely comprehensive presentation, not only on the Maidan, but on the political system, implications for the West, and also what's going on in the region there. So I'm just kind of like struggling to see how I could be a sort of discussant in a short space of time, because we also want to hear from Matt. So I thought I'd just focus on a few points and start by turning to the title of this presentation, which was Ukraine's Lesson Learned from the Orange Revolution to the Euromaidan, and just sort of say that I think lessons learned actually is a sort of narrow way of looking at this, what's going on in Ukraine right now, and putting it into the context of what's happened over the last 20 years. This is not the first mass protest that has taken place in Ukraine. In fact, there have been three major ones. We heard about the Orange Revolution, there's the Euromaidan. But I'd like to remind people who were around at the time, and there are some of you who were, the mass protests of October 1990 that also actually was started by students and really led to a lot of changes both in and pose the question, I mean, are lessons learned, is that the right question to be asking? I mean, shouldn't we be asking, you know, is Ukrainian history just doomed to repeat itself? What are the similarities, what are the differences in these movements, these protests? And actually, is there a pattern and a particular profile now that's emerging of something that we can call Ukrainian political culture, and what does that consist of? And I'll just kind of mention a few elements that I think should be considered if we start looking at the Ukrainian political culture. One element I see, confirmed by Sergii's presentation, is that reformers tend not to go into Ukraine's various governments. Unlike Russia in the 1990s, where there actually were reformers in the government, Ukraine never really had many reformers in the government. A couple maybe, but none that really were of any significance. Another element, it's the student leaders, the students who normally start the protests, as we've seen at least three times now, and generally they are excluded as soon as the political process takes over after the protests have died down. And also, another element, the people who go into government in Ukraine are not there to make the country a better place or to serve the people. So they rule for a while, they accumulate more power and wealth until the Ukrainians get fed up of them and get fed up of being abused, and then they start to protest again. Sorry to simplify it so much, but I think basically that's what we've had over these last 20 years. But I would also say that each time there's a major protest in Ukraine, something dramatic happens, not just in Ukraine, but in the world. After the 1990 protests, the Soviet Union fell apart. I mean, of course, it was as a result of the agreement between Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia that took place in that hunting lodge in Belarus in December of 1990. But really, it needed Ukraine to participate in that process. Otherwise, the dissolution of the Soviet Union may not have taken place quite in the same way that it did. In 2004, there was also an effect. It's really the Orange Revolution, well, together with the Rose Revolution a bit, that has given us this term color revolutions. And I would argue that this is a sort of purported model that has been taken up by protest movements, that was taken up by protest movements all around the world after that, and not always very successfully, I should say. There was also a negative side to the 2004 Orange Revolution, which was that this really mobilized Vladimir Putin to refine and create new instruments of authoritarian rule that he's been sharing around the world with other members of the Dictators Club ever since then. So what's going to happen after the Euromaidan? What kind of precedent will it set? What kind of processes will develop? Well, we don't really know yet how it's going to end, and that he has laid out at least four scenarios. I counted there four, all of which are plausible. But I'd like to throw in a few more points on that. After the Euromaidan, Ukraine has become absolutely another country. People have changed. Unlike the Orange Revolution, people and activists now realize that no leader will solve their problems for them, and that they must become engaged citizens and work for a better future themselves. I heard this repeatedly in the short time that I was on the Maidan, and I think it's a notion that new generation of activists really carries around with it. Another point, which actually said he illustrated very well, that we can see the day-to-day life of the Maidan. The barricades have actually created, he called it a country. Well, maybe it is. It's a space that is free from Yanukovych and free from the regime. It's self-organized. Thank you for providing. I was thinking about how many people they feed in any one day. You provided some figures. And also you mentioned all of the other sort of social aspects of it, university, newspaper, medical facilities, and so on. And this, I think, is a sort of important form of protest that I can see that may inspire other people around the world who also want to do something similar. We shall see. What's been the effect on politics and politicians? Well, there were two parliamentarians from Ukraine here last week. We had a meeting with them. I think some people here were also present at that meeting, and they said something very interesting. In addition to giving a good report as to what was going on the Maidan right now and what was going on in the parliament, they said new politicians are being born on the Maidan and some are fading away. Well, actually, they said there are some politicians who are dying on the Maidan, which, and I think that said he then challenged them as to who was dying. So I've actually translated what they said as some politicians are fading away, because I think they didn't really want to name any names of those that are leaving the scene. So what's happening as a result of Maidan is this sort of accelerated and intense process of bringing current political leaders closer to the people than they've ever been before. And also there's a process of growing new leaders who have the authentic trust and support of people they are leading and working with, which again, I would argue, is actually something somewhat new in Ukraine. What kind of new political system emerges out of this process remains to be seen. Clearly, there should be a constitutional process, as we've heard, and that one that once and for all moves away from a super presidential system, and that presidential system that enabled the executive to take over the courts and manipulate organs of law enforcement as well as dominate the economy. So that is something that I think people are beginning to understand better than they ever did before. And another element here, again, the effect of the Maidan on the political party system also remains to be seen. Leaders are rising and falling, but the parties themselves have an example now of the political leaders on the Maidan have realized, as Sergii pointed out, that it's the people who should give them their mandate. Up until now, quite often, political parties in Ukraine have been organized from the top down. And now the political leaders on the Maidan are really kind of scrambling to keep up with the people who are providing them with the mandate and with their legitimacy. At the end of the Maidan, there will most likely be a few new parties, and maybe some of the old ones will wither away. We still don't know. Another important element, the role of civil society in these developments has been crucial. And Ukraine's civic groups actually have been called upon to carry out functions and activities that are beyond our normal understanding of civil society in the West. These are not de Tocqueville's public associations. Ukraine's civic sector has matured very quickly over the past 3 months. I mean, it was fairly advanced before, but it's been called upon to perform many functions and behave in a way that I think if we continue calling this civil society and assume that it's the same as in Western countries, then we should really sort of rethink that. These new actors of civil society are playing a major role in what is becoming the new Ukraine, and maybe there should be some rethinking as to whether there should be a more formal role in government for them. Also, a final element here, which Sergii did not mention, maybe you can actually talk about that a little bit, but the way that at least 10 of the oblast executive councils have been taken over by protesters. This is something that is often not covered by journalists who focus on Kyiv, but even if the Maidan is resolved somehow, then you have at least, is it 10?
No, it's less than 10. It's about
4 or 5.
Some of them just decided to share the power with real authorities.
So they're coming to some sort of resolution.
Yeah. But on local level, they have much more closer relations on top level, I mean opposition and government.
These are the provincial level executives that have been taken over by protesters, and now that they've sort of experienced this sort of period of self-rule, which in fact they sort of had 10, 15 years ago, it's going to be difficult again to reimpose a dominant role by the center, which is also another aspect of Ukraine's political life that will need to be sorted out. Well, maybe there are actually some lessons for the West. I would focus on three. This entire process has highlighted to me the importance of getting the constitution right the first time. Ukraine adopted a new constitution in 1996, and in fact it had all of the elements in it of a presidential system which evolved into a super presidential system. And I think if we as a sort of Western support community have anything to do with it, we should try and make sure that those constitutions are, if we're asked to, that is, are put in place in the right way right from the beginning. The second point I would say is that this whole process again has reinforced for me that the importance of pushing hard for reform in the early days of a transition. I would say shock therapy for the economic system, which worked very well in Eastern Europe and at the beginning in Russia, and also some kind of shock therapy for the institutions of government. Don't know how we would do that, but still. And then the third point, support for the infrastructure of democracy, and especially political parties. We need to rethink and reframe what we think of as civil society and also what we expect from civil society, and also be very open to what people are asking us for and more active with, as we try to be, with support and help. I'll just finish that.
Thank you very much, Nadia. And now we'll hear observations from Mark Minsky.
Thank you, Chris. And I think, like both of you, it's just hard not to be moved by what you see in Kiev. Ukrainians are very good at this now. They're very good at these massive protests. They're an incredibly musically talented nation. The spontaneous singing of the national anthems, of sort of folk song. They have great rock bands. It's super, and this is what started it all. I think your tail end of what Nadia was saying is, you know, somewhere in the out years, what might happen in Ukraine. But it seems to me that really the decisive events that will determine the outcome here, we won't see. What will be decisive isn't what happens in the streets of Kiev. It's going to be what happens behind the scenes. And here we can really speculate about what the critical actors are thinking or might be doing. The first one that Sergei mentioned, I think is worth talking about a bit more, is the oligarchs. They're about a dozen guys who run half the economy. They own everything in Eastern Ukraine. They own a lot of stuff in Western Ukraine. You know, Akhmetov, I stayed in his hotel in Kiev. I'm sure I shopped his stores. I definitely used his electricity. You know, the guy is worth $15 billion in a country with a GDP, which is not that much more than that. So what are these guys thinking? You know, they were with Yanukovych, and everyone's, you know, they're hedging their bets. Of course they're hedging their bets. They're businessmen. The oligarchs were obviously in bed with Yanukovych. They came with him to the dance. They got him to the dance, and they did very well in the last 3 years. But they've also been giving money to Udar, which is Vitaly Klitschko's party. They've been giving money to, I've heard even that, you know, some money from the Eastern oligarchs has gone to Svoboda, which is the, you know, the Western Ukrainian party, just in case. And it's been a lot of overly optimistic thinking that these guys are about to jump. And I think that's still a bit premature. They have a hard call to make. They're obviously angry at Yanukovych because he centralized a lot of power around his family. His son has done a little bit too well. Yanukovych is clearly trying to become the richest guy in Ukraine, which means that they have less leverage over him. They have been shut out of some state contracts over the years. That makes them a bit unhappy. I think underneath, too, they are drawn to the EU market. They want to go legit. They want, you know, real property rights in Ukraine, so they don't have to worry about losing, you know, the $15 billion, which wasn't all gotten in the most honest ways. But at the same time, you know, do they really want to pay a lot more for Russian gas? Do they really want a you know, proper rule of law in Ukraine? Clearly, there was a move with Akhmetov that he told his MPs, and he controls about 50 MPs, you know, that after things got violent, that was going a bit out of hand. But I think you may need some sort of deal behind the scenes. Adrian Karnitsky has a sort of great line about, you know, what Ukraine needs is this Magna Carta, that deal where the oligarchs are happy, that their rights Now, Yanukovych may be open to that, but you got to remember that Yanukovych has been playing for years in the West versus Russia. I can balance them in both and get stuff for both of them. He has now put himself into a corner with only Vladimir Putin next to him because he's so angered the Europeans and Americans. And by the choice of actions over the last, basically the last 4 months, he is now sitting next to Putin, and Putin's got a pretty big gun, and it's pointed at his head. And so I think Yanukovych is, you know, his freedom of maneuver isn't that great. I mean, he knows that his family, his own wealth, his own security may be in danger. He also knows that, you know, now he only has money coming from Russia, although they've now frozen that $15 billion package. But if he's going to survive, and if the economy is going to survive through next year's elections, it'll have to be with Russia. And I'll get to where how the West might be able to mitigate this. But this brings us to Russia, which is the other really important actor here. They haven't yet begun to really play here. This is the most blatant heavy-handedness that took place in the last few months before the signing or the scheduled signing of the EU deal, where, you know, going against all WTO laws, Putin slapped all kinds of trade tariffs, he blocked the border, he really made them suffer. And that clearly, you know, this is a hard power, it's almost admirable to watch. And he got away with it, you know. Sort of Yanukovych went up, said, okay, I'm going through. The Russians can do a lot more. You know, they could destroy the Ukrainian banking system very easily. They could sort of cut off the gas supplies, but apparently Ukraine's fine for the end of the year. They have enough in stock to make it that far. They haven't started doing anything in Crimea, but they certainly could. And I think if you're Vladimir Putin, you see it, you know, with Georgia, we divided it up a little bit, some instability, and we came out pretty well. Moldova, kind of the same thing happened. Ukraine is kind of the one giant example of where instability in Ukraine is not against Russia's national interest, as long as it keeps Russia out of the Western camp. Sorry, as long as it keeps Ukraine out of the Western camp, although it also keeps Russia out of the Western camp, too. Which brings me to the last actor behind the scenes, the EU and the US. Now, it's still not clear to me that anyone in this town or in Brussels understands the gravity and the importance of what is, Misha Sakashvili has a good term, the first geopolitical war of the 21st century. The Americans didn't, let the Europeans handle Yanukovych over the last few years, finally woke up, are doing a bit more. But they haven't done anything. I mean, they revoked 12 visas, and that happened out of the Kiev embassy. They say we're considering sanctions, but they haven't been at all specific about, you know, who might be on the list, what would trigger a list to be created. They could be much more outspoken about, you know, we know where your money is, Mr. Akhmetov and friends. We can, make it very hard for you to access it. And if we act, the Europeans who've been, who haven't done anything to even prepare sanctions for weeks, which prompted the one peek we got behind the scenes was that leaked conversation last week. And apparently that happened on January 25th, which is before the Munich conference, but there was real frustration here that, the Europeans haven't even started talking about this. It's gotten better after Munich, but still, I still think that in Washington, do you think President Obama spends more than, you know, how much does he think about what's going to happen with Ukraine? Joe Biden started calling Yanukovych again, great, after weeks of not doing anything. So I think that makes me worried that all the good things we see, and again, Ukraine, I can't think of a country where the quality of its people is so far removed from the low quality of its political class. It's been true for 20 years, and I think the Maidan shows that. But you also have an entrenched political slash business slash oligarchic system that will not be that easily unwound. I think this is going to be a very important moment, and where the West is going to have to play a much bigger role than it has so far.
And what I'd like to do before we open up to questions is to give Sergei just a moment to respond to anything that you've heard that you might want to take a moment to respond to.
Thank you.
I would like just add one point about the Russian influence on the banking system of Ukraine. Of course, there is Russian influence, but the influence of Ukrainian oligarchs on the banking system of Ukraine is much bigger. And the real guy who keep the key for the Ukrainian banking system is not a Putin. His name is Igor Kolomoisky, who owns the bank number one in Ukraine with millions of customers all over the Ukraine. And this guy, this oligarch, Igor Kolomoisky, was under pressure of the presidential administration, but he just answered that, if you blackmail me, I'm going to blackmail you, and if you will attack me, I will just destroy my bank instead of it. And after that, officials like left him, and they did not take. And this oligarch now just on the side of protesters, because his TV channel 1+1 is number one in covering of Ukrainian revolution.
So why don't we go to questions? I'd kindly ask those who'd like to ask a question to identify themselves, affiliation, please, and if you could form your question, your informal question, that would be great. Why don't we'll do three at a time, if that's okay. We'll start here in the front. We'll do these three. Start with the gentleman.
My name is Dennis DeSantis. I'm an economic development consultant to Ukraine. I'd like to ask the panel a question. Are the members of the Rada still elected by the party list, or do they come from a district? If they're still from the party list, wouldn't that be a major reform to have a candidate representing a district and more accountable to the people?
Bogdan Kantor, a library economist. Nadia mentioned that these mass uprisings were started by students, the three that you mentioned. There are so-called political leaders now on the Maidan. Do any of them pay attention to the students and listen to them?
Hello everybody, I want to thank for the presentation. My name is Nikolai Vorobyov, recently I came from Kyiv. I'm a blogger and chief editor of Europatrol, it's a think tank. I was one of the who came to Maidan on the first day of protest, and of course I want to submit what Sergei told about what's going on in Ukraine. I have several questions. I mean, to Sergei first.
Just one question, please.
It's too short. It's very short. We should understand what's going on inside Maidan. So, on the one hand, we have like kind of peaceful revolution. Yes. So people just make peaceful pressure on government, and it longs like for almost like 3 months. We can imagine these circumstances for people who stayed out of the streets. It's like minus 20 degrees and so on and so on. When some of them can be shot or just kidnapped, so it's like a horrific situation. On the other hand, we see that basically, and people, of course, like usual people, like in private conversation, they're waiting for some changes. So the question is how is effective this kind of like peaceful revolution like, in this situation? I mean, now we have only like two like positive points, which one of them is like resignation of the Azarov and his like luxury staying in Austria, and another is like
Lenin.
You're right. So I mean, this and how effective is kind of this kind of peaceful revolution, and do you expect some like more like radical steps from Russians after Sochi Olympic Games will be finished, because you know this the main attention on the whole world now on the focus particularly on Sochi. What happens if Olympic Games will have of course it will finish like in 20th of February like
Alexander is elected by 50% from list and 50% from constituencies. But of course, in the agenda of negotiation now, it's not only constitution but election system. Of course, European Union and OSCE and American government too paid money for Ukrainian government to prepare election code with the system of open list. It means that you can select some candidates from open list and then they became MPs. So I believe that in case of like peaceful resolution of crisis, there will be new election system with open list. At least this is like part of negotiation, because current voting system is completely unfair, because half of parliament is elected by just brutal money from candidates, and another part is elected by political corruption when politicians pay bribes for the leaders to be in the election list. So I believe that a new election system could be one of the outcomes of current developments and revolution in Ukraine. Regarding the leaders, do they pay attention to students? I don't really can say that they do. I think now we have separation of like leaders and Maidan. And I don't really remember the examples when leaders really accounted the students' requests. No? I don't remember, because now negotiation is about new government and nothing about.
Well, you can gauge a little bit as well. The Sunday rallies that take place every week, there have been 10 of them now, and I've been monitoring every single one of them. And I think student leaders appeared at most at two of them, maybe only at one. Mm-hmm. So, again.
So they are not on the stage, at least.
We're
not on the
repeating
stage.
That same pattern. Yes, but they're very present, actually, on the Maidan.
No, of course, students, like, it's one of the main participants of Maidan. And the revolution was started because of the students, because when Mustafa, my friend, a journalist from Ukraine, invited people to Maidan, there were 200 or 300 activists. But next few days, students from all over Kyiv, from universities and institutes, came to Maidan to support the first phase of Maidan, and there were thousands of people because of the students. So they were the students. This movement, it was momentum for the revolution.
Yeah, and Nadia did mention that, but she also mentioned that they were not, the youth were not allowed to participate in the political process.
Unfortunately, they do not participate.
The same thing on the third
one. Only it was like one funny story when it was like round table between president and opposition leaders. And there were like leaders of civil society, and also there was one representative of students' union. And this guy was like fake leader of students' union, so just, you know, like from presidential administration side. So he was sitting on the side of protesters, but in fact he was involved in some business with presidential administration. And regarding the question, do you want to add something?
Student uprising. I mean, it really, you know, there were a few, I mean, it's a group from Mohilo, which is very involved, and obviously in the first early days. But when it blew up big, and it's cross-generational, cross-social class, and I think there seems to be a kind of a Paris Commune-like organization where it's very much led by the protesters and the leaders, you know, the opposition leaders who've emerged out of this sort of trio, are very wary of getting ahead of the Maidan, of claiming any legitimacy from themselves, of being, it's not like in 04, where it was clearly about Yushchenko and his contested election. This is not about them, and I think they seem to understand that. And they also are aware that they cannot do things that the Maidan would reject, which is what they quite turned down that government deal from Yanukovych to join the coalition government immediately, because that would be thrown away. And I think that they have to with the opinion of the square. They can't act independently. Just on Sochi, I think Russia can walk and chew gum at the same time. I mean, they're not going to... thinking that, oh, maybe now's the time to move in, the West could move in and try and pry away Ukraine by offering an economic package, political immigration package, and Russia won't notice and not want to embarrass itself. Russia's going to notice. They have interest there, and they're very involved. And I think it's going to play out for a little while longer. But really, the problem would be great if the West did that, but I haven't seen any proof in the last 20 years that the EU in any way is willing to consider the possibility of a Ukraine in the Union one day.
I think it's fair to say that even domestically right now, between TV rating and the consolidation of the arbitration court in Russia, there's plenty of repression going on during the Sochi Games that's perhaps even being hidden a bit by the Sochi Games while we're...
We're being told on NBC by David Remnick that, you know, that Putin has brought stability and growth to Russia, like in the days of Andropov.
So why don't we take several more questions? There's a gentleman in the back, and then we'll come to you.
John Kunstadter, Radzim Bopono. Mr. Leshchenko, thank you very much for your work with Ukrainska Pravda and your cooperation with Hromadske TV. I'd like to ask... Yes, thank you for the work you do for Ukrainska Pravda, the journalism that it carries out, and for your cooperation with Hromadske TV. I'd like to ask you if you could discuss three groups that so far haven't come up in today's discussion. One would be maybe a psychological profile of the Tidushki, I guess you could call them the hired thugs of the regime. Two, the general mood in central and eastern Ukraine. Do you sense that, in fact, there's much more sympathy for what the Euromaidan represents than maybe we can see on the surface? And third, the impact of Metropolitan Filaret and other leaders in the Roman Catholic, Greek Catholic, and Ukrainian Orthodox Church. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Patrick Breslin. I'm a writer and photographer. I spent part of each year in Ukraine. I just have one question about what seems to me to be a disconnect. Most of the discussion, a lot of the discussion, has been about the oligarchs in Ukraine, the amount of power they wield, the possibility that it might have something to do with the resolution of the current situation. And at the same time, Nadia, in her presentation, made the remark that the shock therapy to the economy worked very, very well. And I would just ask whether there's any connection between shock therapy and the current system in Ukraine. Thank you.
I'm take one more question here.
My name is
Melanie.
Today there appeared a map in the newspaper showing division of Ukraine according to five regions or three regions, a potential way that Russia may go. Leshchenko talked about federalization of Ukraine. There have been talks in the past about Piedmont Ukraine, Western Ukraine going separate towards the European Union. I'm kind of interested in hearing, are those potential scenarios, are they really potential scenarios, and where would you see those scenarios going? To what degree a federalization of Ukraine is a solution or would be seen as a viable solution, and to what degree any kind of division of Ukraine is something that could happen in the near future?
It looks like federalization is one of the solutions, yeah? Because I feel it like you maybe, because they started this campaign to produce this like maps of three parts of Ukraine, western, central, eastern, and the same map was produced 10 years ago before the presidential election, when they produced like part of negative propaganda from side of Yanukovych, these three parts of Ukraine. So I believe that in their moves, it's like part of the solution. I mean Yanukovych and some of his allies connected with Moscow. Because federalization of Ukraine is one of the possible scenarios which Moscow is looking for. I think so. But how possible is it? For this, you need to adopt a new constitution, at least. And to adopt a new constitution, you have to have at least two rounds of voting in parliament, if it takes at least half a year, or you have to have a referendum. And if I remember, at least, you even need to referendum plus voting in parliament, because this idea of federalization, it's about part of constitution which is protected by special rules. So you need first referendum and then two rounds of voting in parliament. So it's possible, but legal frames for this scenario, it's quite difficult. But I cannot exclude that in future we will see this idea like part of the agenda on the table from the Yanukovych side.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to sort of intercede there when you said that federalization was a possible solution, because but then you followed up and said that actually this is, you know, all of the sort of propaganda that's coming out from Russian news sources actually proposes that. So you can only see that federalization actually is a sort of code word for splitting up Ukraine, which there were attempts in the 1990s to do the same thing. It really isn't a realistic solution to provide any sort of basis for developing Ukraine. And you know, just to say more about what that, the view, can we call it propaganda from the Kremlin? Well, maybe let's call it propaganda from the Kremlin. I mean, it's a very easy solution for what should happen to Ukraine. There should be instability created throughout the country, which would lead to a division of Ukraine and an isolation of Yanukovych from either east or west. And those are the themes that come up continually in the Russian press. So any discussions of federalization, I think, have to be handled very carefully.
I agree. I can only add that federalization, it could be part of scenario for Russian circles around Yanukovych, not from Yanukovych himself, because in fact, there is no sense for him to do this, but for Medvedchuk, who is a provider of Russian influence in Ukraine, former head of presidential administration, it's possible. And also, I mentioned Vladislav Surko, who is a main advisor of Putin, and he is in charge of Ukraine since the revolution. So I cannot exclude that Surko and his team work together on this scenario, especially if we remind this map of three sorts of Ukraine, and as I recalled just a few seconds ago, that this map was prepared by spin doctor. His name is Vladimir Granovsky, and now he works with Surkov. So, and this map of three sorts of Ukrainians, it was prepared 10 years ago by political advisors of Yanukovych. Now this guy works together with Surkov. So I cannot exclude this scenario, but we'll see. Would you like to?
Yeah, I think, I mean, federalism would not be a bad thing for Ukraine. I think there was a lot of resentment where Yanukovych, you know, borrowed the Putin strategy of picking the oblast governor, which should be an elected position. I think Ukraine, it's a real danger because Ukraine can only be a more multilingual than multi-ethnic, but it can only be a multilingual construct. There are people in the East who fear people from the West with their bandera flags because they don't know them, they think they will make them, you know, Euromaidan has to be very wary of. You know, the nationalists, hardcore nationalists, represent a small minority in the country. It doesn't mean that there's no Ukrainians in Central Ukraine. Actually, it's majority Ukrainian. Everywhere is majority Ukrainian. So it's not an ethnic divide. And it's much less of an East-West divide than it was in 2004. People in the East don't like Yanukovych either. They see how rich he's gotten, and they see how poor they've gotten, and they see that he's not come through his promises. And I think this is a great opportunity, in a way, for someone like Klitschko. Klitschko is a ideal, you know, because of many political flaws, he's also untested, but he's a national hero in Eastern Ukraine. He speaks Russian with his wife at home, you know, but he's a proud Ukrainian. I think he actually speaks German better than he speaks Ukrainian. But he tries, you know, and I think he's someone who has made a bit of an effort to go to the East, to talk to them, saying, you should be in Maidan too. This is not about, you know, the Western Ukrainian folks. You know, this is really a national movement. And I think that's potentially its great advantage, but it should be more exploited, and they should really be careful not to fall in the trap of the country can only be divided.
I want to be mindful of the clock, especially with the impending weather, so I want to give the last question to Mark and the partner, and then we'll have a chance to respond to the student.
Mark Patton, Journal of Democracy. You all prudently refrain from making predictions as to what will happen. You offered several different scenarios and so on. But I'm wondering, in terms of the timeline, whether you could be pinned down in the sense of is the current standoff, if there's something that can last, could you be 3 months from now still out? Maidan occupied, nothing decisive having happened to change the situation? Or are there certain events, political events in the calendar or other things that will drive something fundamental to change, let's say, in the next 3 months?
Just very briefly, I mean, if I was advising Yanukovych, I would tell him to stop doing this. Because every time he does something very stupid, and it makes things worse. When he tried to clear the Maidan in December, when he passed the demonstrations law in January, this is the real weakness of the opposition. They have no formal leverage. There's no sort of constitutional lever they can use to get their demands, which is a new technocratic government, potentially early presidential elections, as they're now talking about. They can't impeach him, barring a wholesale defection of the party of the regions to the other side. But he's done many stupid things, and I think that's really the wild card. What's the next one? And if you get more violence, which is very possible, that may be a reckoning that he's going to have with the Russians and with his own oligarchic backers.
Okay, there are a few other things that weren't responded to, but maybe let's just focus on Mark's question. I think that there is an interest in the governmental Yanukovych side to sort of string out the negotiations. I mean, you can see it happening like day after day, that the place where some sort of resolution could be achieved, which at the moment is the parliament. The session is closed for technical reasons. The majority is standing firm. There are no real sort of review of bills going on. And I think probably part of that is to attempt to just sort of have everything fizzle out. Well, so he said that, you know, the Maidan might degrade, but I don't really see that happening, because at the same time as there aren't any sort of major repressions going on right now, but there are people in Kyiv and also outside of Kyiv that are having their cars burned. There are people still being abducted. There are still people being beaten up, and that's on a local level, which is in a sense sort of this sort of slow burn, and it is still fueling the urge to go to the Maidan and stand firm. And there's another positive factor as well. I think Ukrainians actually like being on the There's a lot of positive energy there. It's going to, and it's going to be spring soon. Well, of course, once you start having to go out to the fields to sow the seeds, I don't know what happens then. But I think Ukrainians can stay there for a long time. Remember in the 1970s and 1980s, Ukraine was considered to be the most sort of apathetic and stubborn republic of the Soviet Union. Well, I think, you know, there are those qualities there as well as singing and dancing. But the thing that I would like to look out for is the Klitschko-Yanukovych debate. Klitschko challenged Yanukovych to debate him.
No, Yanukovych challenged Klitschko.
Yanukovych challenged Klitschko. Well,
First of all, Klitschko challenged
Yanukovych a couple of weeks ago, and now there's been a response from Yanukovych, which shows that he's taking it seriously, but wants to do it not on the Maidan, but on TV. So let's see how that goes.
You're welcome to Kiev to the stage, to see this debate on the stage. You know? Absolutely for free, because tickets for Klitschko's boxing is like hundreds of dollars. You know?
So, Sergii, why don't you take the last word?
There are some questions I didn't respond about. Feel like, I believe that the role of the Orthodox Church is incredible, and feel that as well as the head of Greek Catholic Church also, they really pay a lot of attention to this protest, and we even remember that Ukrainian Ministry of Culture, which is responsible of religious issues, they sent the letter to head of Greek Catholic Church with like respond, do not participate in the events of Maidan because we will persecute you. Because of this, and after that it was a scandal in Ukraine. So I think it was signal of that the role of church is significant in current process in Ukraine. And you also asked me about Eastern Ukrainians. Half of protesters, they're from Eastern and Central Ukraine. It's not my like fantasy. This is numbers from research prepared by democratic institutions, democratic initiatives. Yeah, NEM Grant, by the way, so well respected organization, and the head of this organization was one of the Reagan-Fascell fellows a few years ago. And it's not like fantasy, so half of protesters who came to Kiev, they are from Central and Eastern Ukraine. And I believe that it's also a clear signal for Yanukovych that he's over. In my opinion, he's over. His game is over. Because he lost the support, and the only way for him to stay in power is just radicalization and provocation, and also using these quasi police forces, bandits, hooligans, and so on. I hope that we will go to the solution through first positive scenario, government of national unity, new constitution. The first step of that should be voting for coming back to the previous version of the constitution, and after that pre-term presidential elections, and as well parliamentary elections, because we need to elect a new parliament using new voting system. So I hope for a peaceful solution in Ukraine, and of course I thank you everybody in this room that pay attention to Ukrainian issues and come here. Despite the snowfall, a great state of emergency. The risk of emergency state in Ukraine is also, but we know that because of that other reason.
Well, I take that opportunity to really commend Sergii for a terrific presentation. And with our commentators, I think in short order, really tackled recent Ukrainian history, gave a shrewd sense of the politics there, and also sketched out what the country will have to struggle through to be governed under a less corrupt and coercive system. So I'd really like to share thanks to them, and thanks to all of you.